My job.
Not cutting it anymore, huh? According to one scientist, it couldn't have come at a worse time to malfunction. It was the day after the warranty ran out. Which always happens. Did you know they found a candy wrapper on Mars? Yeah, they did. It said Earth Bar on the Viking 1 mission. Been sensational. The pictures have been magnificent. But now, according to the Jet Propulsion Laboratory, the space lab is having trouble with the... What?
Extend.
Yeah, that probing arm that is supposed to go out and in a few days pick up some of the Martians. So the extender, that's very good. Now, you sound good tonight. This is a Viking 1 audience.
How's that?
Good, good, very good. Well, they're just waiting to scoop up the jokes and analyze them. If nothing else works, they figured out a surefire way. I'll give you a 9.95 for that. You'd have got a perfect 10. But the fellow over here fell out of his seat, made a bad landing. So it's not a 10 tonight. How are you? You sound great tonight. It's Friday night. This is the Tonight Show, which is on television as a public service. Has to give Jim McKay time to go to the John. Never see Jim away from that desk. That bothers me,
Johnny's Animal Experts.
You really like it when I get in trouble, don't you? Be going too good tonight. Let's move on to the political arena and see what's happening. Jimmy Carter is back in New York after vacationing in Plains, Georgia, and he met with the leading businessmen in New York City yesterday, heads of big corporations, and they got along very well, Carter and the big businessmen, because they got something in common. He raises peanuts, and that's what they pay in taxes. So that's working. Now, let's see. I just saw the news before I came out here tonight. Reagan claims, and Ford now claims, that they each have enough delegates to get the nomination on the first ballot at the Republican convention. Both claim, and both of them can't have it. And President Ford, I understand today, gave strict orders to his staff that they're not to promise anything, any personal favors, to any uncommitted delegate just to get their vote. As a matter of fact, the president was very adamant about it today. He told one delegate right to his face. He said, it would be wrong of me to promise you any political appointment just to get your vote. Says, as a matter of fact, I shouldn't even allow you to be sitting on my lap now. It was in New York, a mugger came up to Carter, actually shoved a gun in his ribs, and said, give me your money or your life, and Carter promised him both. As they call him in the Senate. Walter Mondale finally settled on a personal campaign strategy. Mondale's going to run as a candidate who most resembles Rodney Dangerfield. He also said it better than I did, Jimmy. He got it out and got a pretty good laugh. You know, I was in California. Elizabeth Ray was on the news here in California last night. Brilliant girl. The IQ of a philodendron. Anyway, she held a press conference at the Beverly Hills Hotel and announced that the producer is going to make this movie about her life on Capitol Hill. Can't you just wait for that? I cannot. It's the story of her loves, I guess her Washington experiences. The movie's going to be called The Elizabeth Ray Story, or Deep Typing. The movie's going to be rated P. No one is allowed in the theater with their pants on. Oh, she's a great intellect. She said, well, the reporters asked if she's going to be nude in the movie. She says, yes, possibly she would appear nude in this picture, but At least now we'll be able to see where our money went. George Hamilton, the story of Evel Knievel, and you know how big that was. In this movie, Miss Ray tries to jump over 18 congressmen. It almost makes it. At what age do you break it to your child that he lives in Burbank? Did you see this? They have a little series of things they do called Close Up and Personal. They do a little profile. And they did one on Princess Anne.
Princess Anne.
Did you see Princess Anne last night?
Yes, I did.
We do not speak the same language.
No.
I don't care what they say.
No way you can understand.
Princess
that.
Anne is a lovely lady, but I couldn't understand.
You do a great imitation of her.
You'd be Jackie Stewart. You know, I mean, he's like this. Tell me, Princess Anne.
Tell me, Princess Anne, when did you start writing?
Yes, you know, I did.
Now, I thought she was bad. Now he went and interviewed her husband, Captain Mark Phillips. If you think she is bad.
Captain Phillips, what is the agony for the loser?
I don't mean to make fun of her in-laws, but I thought he was physically ill. Well, we'll be back, Marv. Interesting. Anyway, that'll do a lot for our international relationship. The Queen has left, hasn't she?
Yes. Tonight
she's leaving tonight, but she's
I'm getting on a plane.
Flip hasn't been here for a while.
That's right. That's right. Incidentally, humorous gentleman. And I hope you'll make him feel at home in his first appearance on The Tonight Show. Would you welcome my first guest of the evening, ladies and gentlemen?
Back with great fondness the fact that I did have my first national exposure on American television here on The Tonight Show. Yeah, my first shot. That was 1965, John. Now I'm back tonight, folks, to ask for a second chance. You know, they say you should always be nice to the people you meet on the way up because you're running into those same people coming back. You know, I didn't accept it. I heard it was a word of Colonel Parker that said, you don't have to be nice to the people going up if you don't intend to come back. But I am. I'm working on my comeback. And it's particularly difficult for me because it's hard to come back when you haven't left. But I'm working on it. In case I should leave, I want you to know that I'm coming back and I'd like for you to hold a place for me.
Information spirit.
Oh, I was thinking tonight, I couldn't wait to ask the child psychologist to come in later about the issue between kids and guns. I, too, am a parent, folks. And I think that we should be very conscious of it when we make promises to kids that we don't intend to keep. I heard an incident a few days ago. Kid came to his father and said, Daddy, nice little kid. Lived with his mother and father. You know, he liked her. I remember that. Don't get a laugh. Kid said, Daddy, can I have a gun? His father said, no. The kid said, but it's my birthday. His father said, you still can't have a gun. Kid said, well, last year you told me next year when my birthday came, I could have a gun. His mother said, well, you're not going to get a gun. The kid was crying. He went to his mother. She loved him, too. The kid said, Mommy, can I have a gun? Daddy said, last year I could. This year he said, no. This father overheard it. And he snatched that kid in the car. He said, you're not going to get a gun. You understand that? Kid said, but you promised. He said, I don't care. He said, you're not going to get a gun. As long as I'm running this house, you're not going to get a gun. The kid said, if I get my hands on a gun, you're not going to be running this house too much longer. I promised to keep it. You know, I heard another incident where the father was too supportive of his kid's conduct with a gun. He bought his kid a gun. The kid wanted one. The next door neighbor came over. He knocked on the door. He said, I want to speak to you. Father said, what is it? This guy really loved his kid. He said, your kid killed one of my chickens with his gun. His father said, he killed that tank. He said, he killed my chicken with his gun. Father said, impossible. We're going to have to toy gun. That's a toy gun. He said, let me see. Father took it to him. He said, here, it's a rifle. No matter how do you kill a chicken with a rifle? The guy took it by the barrel and said, like this. That's a very thin line between whether you should let the kid have the gun or not. So I want to discuss child psychologists. They come out here. But I really had in mind coming out here tonight, folks, I'm going to do some revenue. I haven't received really, really, you know? Because, you know, I think that myself, more than any other comic, has a bigger chain of communication between the ministers around this country. You know, ministers all over this country are writing me constantly, keeping in touch, because they know that we're all working for the same executive. I remember Reverend Leroy, the first time I saw him perform. Well, I call it a performance. It was a little church, and Reverend Leroy came, just come into town. And he'd been there, coming out of the church 3 or 4 months now. And he spoke to the congregation from the bottom of his heart. When I was right there in the audience, folks. It's real, I remember it. It was over yesterday. He spoke to the congregation. He said, brothers and sisters, said, I have come to this town to build the tabernacle, to pay tribute. Said, and I'm sure that all of you there, said, you, and you, and her, and him. That I'm sure that all of you know that I did not come to town first class on a 747. That I did not come to town in a long train of limousines. Said, and I did not come in the comfortable new coaches of the people that say leave the driving to us. That I hitchhiked into this town. And many of you remember me because you passed me on the highway. And friends, I've come here and tried to build something. Said, I'm sure that all of you, as I do, know that we must progress. We must progress. And the congregation yelled, let's progress, Rev. Let's progress. They said, well, if this church is going to progress, first, it's got to crawl. This church must crawl. The congregation yelled, let it crawl, Rev! Let it crawl! Rev said, and after this church is crawled, it must stand up. This church must stand up and walk. And the congregation yelled, make it walk, Rev! Make it walk! Rev said, and after this church has walked, this church must run! The congregation yelled, make it run, Rev! Make it run! Rev said, and for this church to run, it's gonna take money. And the congregation yelled, let it crawl, Rev!
Love those stories. Let me take a break. Then I'm going to see if I can talk into doing one story he did a long time ago. I'll tell you what it is in a second. We'll be right back.
Either that or they got the arm working on a Viking probe. One of the two is now getting the soil.
The story I asked you to tell, you say, hey, that
Well, there are a lot of stories that I used to do that I don't do anymore, John, because
but people gotta come to you and say, hey.
Yes, I get a lot of requests, but I feel that the caliber of story that the American public wants now is different from the stories of that time.
Uh-huh.
At that time, we were more confused, and we needed stronger humor.
Thanks for dropping by tonight. Patty Boone, Tom Grease, and Dr. Lyndon Smith. And I should point out, occasionally on this show, we book somebody, and sometimes they don't appear, they get bumped. As you well know,
yes,
I heard you do a routine once after you'd been on the show and you became a hit. Some benefit of one of those Friars things. He went through a routine. He was booked on this show, what was it, five?
I got bumped five. I hold a record.
Five times.
In a row.
Nobody heard of Flip, and we booked him on that. The show ran long.
Which also gave me the distinction of being the highest paid guest.
That's right. And he got paid every night. Five times he didn't go on. So if some young comedian is watching and doesn't get on, what happened?
That's right.
That was 1965.
Yeah.
Sheesh. It's incredible. That really is incredible.
Yeah, but I've had a big cookie.
Yeah.
You know, that lately. Oh, did you mention it next month?
I'm going to. Yeah.
You're gonna be, yes, I am.
You're going to be hosting here for next month?
We're having a party for a week next month.
A balloon party?
Yeah, we're going to have a party all week. I hope you remember. See, they even started a party already.
I see.
You know?
Yes.
But there were some funny stories, though. That's a funny story. Just don't do it anymore. Because now, at the time the story would have been hip, but now to do a story like that is bad taste because people have grown beyond it. Funny story. I never told you that.
I don't think so.
Look, it's the story about the prejudiced parrot?
No.
Oh, yeah. I mean, I'd like to do it.
Yeah.
And a few years ago, I would have done it.
Watch.
Now?
Do it tonight.
Okay.
I haven't heard it.
Okay. It was this fellow on
the parrot. Doing the dip, you must understand, so it makes no difference, right?
Fellow on the parrot, got a little financial difficulty. He goes to the pawn shop and says, I want to sell this parrot. And the parrot says, okay. Then the guy says, look, I got to tell you, this parrot is prejudiced. I've had him for years, and he doesn't like black people. He said, so when you sell the parrot, be sure that you try not to sell it to a black person. If you do, explain to them the parrot's background. Because your parrot doesn't like black people. I said, okay, well, I'll keep that in mind and I'll make sure that I convey that to the possible owner. And about 5 minutes later, so a brother walked in the shop there, said, you got any parrots? And the fellow said, yes, we do have one parrot. And he said, but before I sell them to you, I'd like to take a moment to run down the parrot's history to you. I said, can the parrot talk? The man said, yes. He said, well, let him run it down his cell. Said, I'm going to just take the bird home, and me and the bird will get in some conversation. We'll rap, and we'll find out what we ought to know about each other. Said, how much you want for the bird? Said, I'll give him $30, and I'll take the bird home. Put the parrot in the cage and he's sitting there looking at the parrot. He said, probably want a cracker. The parrot kind of turned around on his perch and rolled his eyes at somebody. You know? Somebody went around the other side of the cage. He said, probably want a cracker. The parrot turned back around on the perch and he crossed his little parrot knees. You know? Looked back over his shoulder and winked at the brother. Somebody went around the other side of the cage and said, probably want a cracker. The parrot said, you want a watermelon? Now, a few years ago, that would have been here. It's a bad taste now.
Yeah, you can't do that stuff anymore. What kind of jokes don't get laughs anymore? No. You can tell. I hadn't heard that. You know what I was talking about was the lady with the ugly baby, but you forgot. I won't push you on that. Freddie's home. You were doing you've already done the Bionic? An episode of the Bionic
Six
Man?
$6 million. I had to. My kids are such a big fan of the show. I guess that if you were Billy somebody, you'd be on the Bionic Man. I just finished a segment on the Bionic Man. Played a comic who was very similar in appearance to the Prime Minister of an African country, which was difficult to cast.
Was it fun?
Yeah, oh, it was fun. And I had to sneak in disguise, and one disguise was a nun, you know. And it was fun.
It was crazy. How's your golf?
Let me tell you. I got to take a moment to thank Jack Nicklaus. I played with Jack at the opening of Sneak.
He was a big knee fan.
Anybody look impressed? I played with Jack at a new course, and he just sent me a set of clubs. Well, let me tell you. He said he would send me a set of the new clubs that he designed.
Yeah.
Okay. At the time, I was involved in an auction. We had a glove there that Nicklaus had signed, and we were auctioning it off. I was handling the bidding. So I started bidding at $10 for the glove, and it stayed there. So I owned the glove, which was big. So I go home and I sold the glove to my kid for $12. He's a big Jack Nicklaus fan. So the kid was leaving town to visit his mother for a couple weeks, so I stole the glove back. So I've been playing with the glove, and then I got home the first day after I played with the glove, and there was this set of clubs. The jacket sent me to ride that day. The glove wasn't on. So I've been playing my best ever with that Nicklaus glove and those clubs. Now, I don't know if it's the glove or the clubs. I won't know until my kid gets back.
Well, you've been traveling? You usually get out sometimes and just...
Yeah. I get out. I travel probably 2 weeks a month. I'm national chairman of the American Cancer Society.
Right.
And in that capacity, I travel couple of times a month to different affairs, and we raise money for the, and it averages about $35,000 each time I make a trip. So we've been humming right along here all year.
Yeah.
I've spoken to just to name drop a little.
Just
I've spoken to Al Green and Stevie Wonder. And I want to have Dodie Goodman. Dodie Goodman and I had some great moments on this show. Yeah. And George Brothers, who I like very, very much. And we're gonna have some
problems.
George is my buddy.
Stevie Wonder, that'll be one of the most talented songwriters and performers in the world. Yeah. Where are you heading? I know you can't stay, but where are you heading tonight? You got something on special?
Yes, I'm gonna play some night golf.
Night golf?
They have a new course open by the airport, but they just installed night lights. And but before I got these Nicklaus clubs, I played my best game at night. Because what I would do is I would hit, and my next hit would be the first ball I reached. And I parred more holes. Whoever it was, I hit it. I didn't have two balls the same in 18 holes.
Hey, thanks for coming back.
Okay, my pleasure.
Great to see you. See you. Cosmopolitan Magazine, which is kind of a kicky magazine, I guess. They're going for a lot of strange quizzes and things that people can do, and there's an article this month, I guess, called At Least Once in a Lifetime. It says certain moments, places, foods, situations are so special, we believe every Cosmo girl should savor them at one time in her life. In other words, special experiences, things you'd like to do, a whim or a fantasy.
Maybe only just once.
Yeah, or something on the spur of the moment you've always wanted to do, and they've asked the people to write in, and they looked over the list. For example, stay up all night and toast the dawn with champagne. Now, you know, that's kind of romantic.
Yes.
When people are stay up all night and come.
You can do that more than once in a lifetime.
We have done that. We have done that. But it wasn't too romantic.
No.
You know, when they're taking your prince. That's not romantic.
No.
Would you just roll it over there? Here's a towel. Okay. They're talking about with the one you love.
Yes.
With the one you love.
I understand.
Bite into a raw but ripe, just picked ear out of corn, right out in the cornfield.
Oh.
Spend your whole bank account on a foreign sports car. You know, you go bananas. Take the controls of an airplane. It'd be nice to know how to fly first. Do one totally charitable act. Make supper for a Bowery bum. That's true. Read aloud to a blind person, deposit $500 anonymous dollars into a broke friend's checking account. Go skinny dipping with your lover. Bake bread.
I've done that.
going skinny dipping with your lover sounds like
better.
More fun. And watching
them both
and watching bread rise. Have a have a professional massage. I suppose versus an unprofessional one. Ride a horse bareback along the ocean. Kiss in the rain. Done that, I'm sure.
Nothing to it.
Make love with all the lights on and your eyes wide open.
That we've done.
And that's why we are where we are today. Found out it wasn't them. Walk. Walk through fresh snow and listen to it crunch. You know, live alone. We've done that too. Anyway,
a lot of these things.
Those are interesting.
What issue was that?
That was just.
I didn't. I was on vacation. I guess I missed that one. That's great though.
Little men's fantasy.
But look at that, all on one page. All on one page. Everything in the world you'd want to do just once. It's captured right there. That's amazing how somebody can do an article and say everything in the world you never want to do one time.
You are wrong, STP Brett.
There's more?
Fantasies and goodies here I don't think that they covered. For example, just once in a lifetime, wear your brassiere on the outside. Put on the television set and dance naked in front of Walter Cronkite. Yeah. Throw up on the supersonic Concorde on the way to Paris. Hang glide in the nude over Police Chief Davis's house. Go on a tour of Universal Studios and tell Alfred Hitchcock to shut up. Take a horse to church. Have an affair in the on-deck circle at Yankee Stadium. See if you're gonna hold a hamburger in your cleavage. Get into a bathtub of hot jello, slice a banana, wait until it sets, and eat your way out with a spoon. Join the teamsters union and blow the pension fund. A little humor there.
Hello, sweetheart.
Go through Lion Country Safari with chopped liver on your shoes. Spend a day at Doris Day's house and get treated like a dog. Pose nude for the centerfold of Playboy and show the world what most people look like. Spike your Preparation H with Snappy Tom.
And each child in a family, and you have five children, they have to be treated.
Let me ask you about this theory that I read some years ago by some child psychologist and said, if you have the room, it's an effective way to do it. When a child misbehaves, you don't hit him, you don't scream, you take him to a place like a room, mm-hmm. which is devoid of all furniture, do nothing to play with, and you put him in that room.
It's a padded cell.
In a way, yeah. Until he, in other words, it's his doing that he's there. Mm-hmm. In other words, you have him until he can
yeah.
relate to other people and behave himself. Mm-hmm. You leave him alone, and no matter whether he screams or kicks or has a temper tantrum,
yeah.
you wait.
You believe in that? Yes, it's often effective. You can get the child in the room, and if he doesn't destroy the room once he's
that's
in
there, what I say. You have to have a place where he cannot do literally anything.
Yeah, like these chimp pads all over the, and it's just all. Now, the idea is to remove all sorts of stimuli because often the parent and the child are both angry at each other, and you have to break this up. And if you can stop and think enough to do that for the child, why it's sort of like what they do with hockey players. They're just, you know. Nasty little children. You have to isolate them every once in a while. Now, but what I'm finding is that people don't need to do that with their children so much if this thing about nutrition, often that it's triggered by a stress thing coming at their blood sugars drop. Here's a typical example that I see all the time. The child comes home from school at 3:30 in the afternoon. He's just the night before he watched one of those television things where the police broke into the apartment. So he comes to the front door and breaks open the door and he comes in. His mother is standing there. What's going to happen today? So now we know what to do. So he's got his mouth open. She shoves this big gob of peanut butter down his throat, sticks him in his room, holds the door shut while he's in there screaming and hollering. After 20 minutes, he comes out and says, hi, Mom. What can I do to help? because his blood sugar comes up. And I know this happens, and if people's blood sugar is down, and the mother says, good afternoon, how was school? He goes, he falls on the floor. But if his blood sugar is low, he can answer the question. It has a lot to do with it. So before you talk to anybody, be sure they've eaten. The same thing happens to me. If my wife speaks to me before I've eaten, she doesn't get the answer that she would deserve.
Doctor, it's a pleasure to have you here. Book, Building a Child's Behavior Chemistry. I hope you come back with us often.
Thank you.
Always.
It's a nice book. I read it every once in a while.
Let's go.
When there's a problem.
Thank you, Tom. This you may find hard to believe, but Pat Boone is an expected grandfather. Ooh. But that I cannot quite, I cannot cope with that. That's like somebody would tell me that Annette Funicello is in the motion picture Country Home. Being fed intravenously. Time passes so swiftly. Who doesn't it? This Sunday at the World's of Fun Amusement Park in Kansas City, Pat will be working. And the next Sunday, July the 29th, the entire Boone family opens at Knott's Berry Farm out here in Southern California. Would you welcome Mr. Pat Boone? Find it remarkable that kisser of yours, that you're going to be a grandfather.
Yes. I mean, time had to come, and it looks like it's upon us now.
Yeah. The thing is, I'm looking at you guys, and I mean, here we are, and I'm going to be the first grandfather.
As far as we know.
I have no grandchildren.
No. But you have prematurely gray hair. And,
no, it's not premature. I got it when I was supposed to get it. People always say that. No, my father, it is. You see how this goes across the front?
Isn't that funny? I noticed that.
People thought that I was streaking this with something. Like I was taking some of that stuff that women used to put streaks in. Yeah. I don't know why. I don't use anything. This doesn't get dark, and this lays across there.
Like by scum.
No, I stood under a tall cow one day. The only thing I'd come up with was tight. But that's just the way it is. I don't know whether to make it all quiet or to put some stuff in it.
I think you should leave it like it is. There's nobody on TV like you. Nobody believes that about it being natural, but just keep it like it is.
Well, my dad was gray very early. Lots of people, can be 60 or 65 and still have dark hair.
Yeah.
And Ed's not going to get really gray hair because his hair is light to begin with.
Right.
See, my hair was very black, and so when you do get it, what am I apologizing for? What is this? It's there.
Well, I'm not ready to be a grandfather, but it's just happening. I wasn't ready to be a father.
Look, you and your daughter can't be any older than you were when you and Shirley had your first child.
No, she is. She's
older.
She's going to be, she'll be 21, and by the time we were 21, we had two, including her. So, she and I are both expecting. She's expecting a baby, I'm expecting a boy.
Did you ever notice when people say, hey, I'm a grandfather, people applaud? Like you have done, I mean, you...
Yeah.
I had very little to do with it. Congratulations.
In fact, it was over all my protests.
Yeah.
I forbade them to even fool around for the first couple of years. And they are doing me the immense good favor of having waited a year.
Well, that's nice. Did you read about that? I made a remark about the other night, about that tribe they found in New Guinea. Was in the paper, the Dani tribe, that when they get married, they do not consummate the marriage until 2 years after they've been married. Then after the birth of their first child, they do not have sexual intercourse again for 5 years.
Yeah.
And anthropologists are trying to figure out why they have no interest, apparently very little interest in sex. But they seem to be happy as clams.
They have very bad skin problems.
They spend a lot of time under the waterfall. A very large waterfall in the Dani tribe. It's very crowded there. No, it is interesting. Anthropologists are trying to figure out why. That seems to be one of the, what they say, inborn. Maybe it's not
it's
an
not a very big tribe either, is it?
And getting smaller. Getting smaller. Tribe next door is growing. But next door, light sleepers.
Yeah.
Maybe we can get one of those anthropologists on some night and talk about that.
And explain that.
And explain that, what they found out.
It's not natural.
No, they don't. No, they say that's not true.
That's what I say.
That's not an instinctive drive. The sexual drive is not an instinctive drive.
What?
That's what they say.
You mean we're all weirdos?
No. It's a learned thing. As you are exposed to or you read about it.
I don't believe that.
Well, that's what I've read. Well, we have Dr. Lennon Smith coming out.
Yeah, he'll be in a hurry.
Maybe we'll find out if children have that natural drive or whether that's a learned experience. Mm. I learned mine. And not well, I might have. There's only... Yes, Fred, I'm going to do this. What?
I want to tell you something about that when you come back.
What? About what?
About what we were just talking
about. Sure. There's only one place you find the Wishbone name on fine salad dressings.
Yeah. Oh, who hasn't? I guess everybody's been watching. And it's tremendous.
I wish Howard Cosell would learn that when something is on television, you can also see it.
Nobody has told us that.
There's the screen there. There are two fighters in the ring.
He talks right through everything.
I like Howard, but there's a picture there. You can see that.
I was thinking about these nations that unfortunately had to withdraw for various reasons, and I know who's going to have the last laugh, because I don't know if Howard has mentioned this, but on the back of every one of those medals, it says Made in Taiwan.
I thought the reason they split, they saw Cosell, and they didn't want to integrate that badly. No, Howard, I'm just kidding. You're right, you're a good athlete, though.
Well, to. Yeah, I love sports, and I stay active, and I really think that I think I'm better at most sports and most everything than I was 15 or 20 years ago. Just because I stay at it, I keep doing it. And everything. And
most people think you peak, you know, at a certain age. And then from then on, you're in the final glide path.
Yeah. No, I haven't started peaking yet. But I was in
Dublin. I can remember when I peaked. It was 48, Thursday afternoon, about 3:30. I'm sorry. You were in Dublin?
In Dublin, and I was there to do a movie, and this was about 8 or 10 years ago. And performers, that is, entertainers, get to be in various kinds of athletic things. We usually make fools of ourselves, and people, I think, enjoy that, including other performers. But I was in Ireland to do a movie, and they had this AAU track meet. And I'd never run track. I love to watch it, but I played baseball, football, basketball, tennis, but not track. And I was out in the infield of the John F. Kennedy Stadium over there, and the track coach said, just idly, you know, just sort of joking, we ought to come back tomorrow night and run with us in the 440 relay because we're minus one dash man. I said, really? And he dropped the subject, and I brought it up again, and I said, you know, I play basketball and I run a lot. Are you kidding? Are you minus a man? He says, yeah, but you'd have to train for it. And I kept bringing it up, but finally he said, look, if you want to do it,
440
relay.
440
means they run 110 yards. And he said, I'll ask the Irish team. He said, it won't be official, but if they want to do it, then you want to run, we'll put you in. So I said, yeah, let's do it. Well, it sounded like a lark. It would be fun. And they decided I would run anchor because the U.S. had three very fast dash men and then me. And they figured they'd make, put me last. Maybe I could come home with the baton. And the Irish team agreed, but then they got to thinking, gee, what if we get beat by three track men and a singer? So they put in Noel Carroll, who was at Stanford, I believe, and he was Irish and he was running on their team, and going for a couple of world records that night, and they put him in anchor against me. Now, I wanted out, but they had the TV crews, and they had a big crowd, and there was no way out. And so we practiced passing the baton.
Right.
And there's several ways. So the easy way, of course, just to look back, and that's slower. But the fastest way, and we decided that's the way we better go for, but it's also the riskiest way, is to put your thumb on your hip, and when the guy enters this certain area, the guy's going to hand you the baton. You start running, and you just have your hand like this, and he flies up behind you, throws it in, and when you feel it, then you go. Now, if you miscalculate or something, then you drop the baton, and the race is over. We did it that way, and the race started. First American dashman built about a 3-yard lead. I'm standing and shaking my boots. Noel Carroll standing back behind me, very cool. The second dashman added another 2 or 3 yards, about a 6-yard lead. The third man, now he's approaching me. Turned out later that when he handed me the baton, I had an 11-yard lead. And I started running. I rounded that turn, which is the shortest part, and I was flying. And I said, man, nobody in the world could catch me. And I got about a third of the way there, and I knew I was running just as fast, but I wasn't getting there quite as readily. And now I hear from Mississippi, Nova Carolina. My feet are going just like Flip was a while ago. And running, I mean running. And I hear boom, 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 these long, slow strides. But I can tell he's gaining on me. And I, when I got to the finish line, my feet were way out in front of me. And that's not very good form. I was way back like this. I ran in faster than I had any right to run. I broke the tape, one half stride ahead of Noah Carroll, which was an amazing thing. But then I couldn't stop. I couldn't stop running. I never realized my legs were like rubber, and I knew that if I stopped, I was going to fall back. And I had to run about another 30 yards before I could just sort of
post to it. That's not bad, though.
I did win, and it was a huge thrill and a fluke. Just a fluke.
You think you're going in the track, right?
No, I gave it up. I quit a winner.
Thing is, dude, I just back it in and say,
yeah,
I won, and I won that shit.
Yeah, I got this game, Lee.
Yeah, that's a great story. We'll do this. We're going to come right back. We have Tom Griesman with us and Dr. Lennon Smith. And here's it.
Thank you, thank you. I was really supposed to be on the show a long time ago, but as things worked out, they ran out of time, and they rescheduled me for another date, and then they ran out of time on that date, and then they ran out of time on that date, and anyhow, I'm here tonight, so I'd like to do for you some of the material I planned to do the first time I was supposed to be on the show a long time ago. A lot of people in the country today have been complaining about President Lincoln. No, I guess that wasn't that long. But President Lincoln and I have a lot in common. For example, he was raised in Illinois, and I was raised in Illinois. And thank you, and you were raised in Illinois. I just got back from working there in Chicago Heights, Illinois, which is an interesting town. 55,000 Italian Catholics. Three families. And one obstetrician, the most overworked man in America. Babies are being born so fast in that town, he didn't have time for surgical gloves. He uses a catcher's mitt. But I like large families because I came from a large family. As a matter of fact, I had eight brothers and sisters, and we were very close. Five of us used to sleep in one bed. Three of those wet the bed. The other two turned out to be great swimmers. I didn't mind coming from a large family, except for one thing, hand-me-downs. See, I had an older sister. You know, it's like going to school and you and the teacher have on the same dress. And he was a lot madder than I was. Another problem with a large family, if you have a little sister, it seems that you have to take her everywhere you go. I finally put a stop to that. I was on the way home from school one night, had my little sister with me, 15 guys with black leather jackets come walking toward us. You could actually feel the fear building up. I don't know what they were afraid of. I wasn't even hurt. One of them spoke. I figured he was the toughest one because he had concrete on his breath. He said, "Hey, creep." I always wondered how he knew my name. He said, "Hey, creep, who you got with you?" I said, "Oh, that's my little sister. If you let me go, you can have her." Largest family in my neighborhood was a Barducci family. They had 17 kids. Now, you know a family's got too many kids when they buy a dog and first day they pet it to death. Mrs. Barducci was an expert at cooking things like stuffed Spam. My favorite Barducci was Melvin Barducci. The reason I like Melvin, he had the dirtiest mind of any kid in the neighborhood. Melvin used to get the filthiest thoughts. He once went to confession, the priest quit and started writing short stories for Playboy. Catholic school was a lot of fun. In fifth grade, we were making our confirmation, and the nun said you have to have a sponsor. A sponsor is an older brother or an uncle who goes to church with you. Melvin went home and told his mom and dad he had to have a sponsor. They sent him to church with a white suit and a sign on the back, Rocky's Pizza. You know what's good about going to Catholic school if you're a poor kid? They dress all the children alike, so you're not supposed to know who's rich and who's poor. But rich kids have a way of letting you know they're rich. The girls come to school wearing a solid gold crucifix. Actual size. And in first grade, the boys pay for their milk with master charge. Here in California, all the rich kids go to one school. It's in Beverly Hills, Our Lady of the Dow Jones Averages. What a bunch of snobs. The school mascot's a mink. The really a genuine junkyard dog. I don't know if you've ever seen any, but they're easy to spot. When you walk into a junkyard, they're always chained to a 53 Pontiac. And no matter who comes in, they manage to pull that car 30 yards and bite them. Then the owner always comes out of that little shack. Oh, get down, Fluffy. My wife and I got a dog recently. We didn't buy the dog. We got up in the animal welfare because we figured if you can't have one naturally, you should adopt one. We've never done that before, but it's not easy to teach a dog tricks. So I got this red rubber ball, and every day for hours, I'd throw the ball, then I'd go after it and bring it back in my mouth. I finally taught the dog to say, attaboy, attaboy. Thank you.
Yeah. You did get bumped a couple of times on that show, didn't you?
The first time I did the show, I was bumped four times.
Oh, I think Flip does on the record was five.
Was yeah. Five. And I think David Steinberg was a five, too.
Yeah. But it is murderous to sit back there and get ready to a show and have your material in mind, and you get kind of all charged up in the rhythm and all of a sudden you're not going on. Did you run out in the streets and just do it for somebody passing by? Because you, you got to do it and get it out.
I tell you what, the hardest part for me was back in Harvey, I'm from Harvey, Illinois, yeah. A suburb, Southside Chicago. And the whole town kept watching the show, and I was bumped and bumped again and bumped again. And
you call your mug folks usually.
Oh,
say,
yeah.
I'm on national television tonight, and you don't show. And she doesn't show mine.
I know. But my poor mother, she was at a grocery store, and some lady said to her, tell me, when is your son ever going to be on The Tonight Show? And she said, I don't know. He keeps getting dumped.
Dumped?
Showbiz already. We'll take a break. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Rocker, please enter the game, Dr. Lennon Smith will be here to explain why we're doing this. That's what children do, right? They throw things at each other.
Hey, you guys,
we never grow up, you see. Dr. Lennon Smith is a frequent visitor to this show, and his current book is called Improving Your Child's Behavior Chemistry and a New Way to Raise Happier Children into Adulthood. Would you welcome baby doctor, little teeny doctor,
Lennon Smith.
I need to straighten some things out.
Raj and I have been on shows before, and we've had the discussions about milk. And in a way, he's right, because milk is an important thing. But I found out recently, and I want maybe people could send you letters to answer this. And somebody said to me, every farmer knows that if you take milk from the cow and give it to, and you pasteurize it and then give it to the calf will die in 6 weeks. That pasteurization does something to some enzyme or some hormone or something in the milk. And
what are human beings doing? Right?
Apparently, but we die too, but it may take us longer to do this. The point is that I've had people now tell me that that their child seems to be allergic to milk, but at least that's the milk in the store, but they get raw milk and the child is not allergic. And I thought, well, it's because they're using Guernsey milk in one from the store, they're using Jersey milk someplace else. So I don't know. There's got to be an answer. So maybe we can take a poll. And the hell people say.
I already don't know.
Well, that's one little thing I found. And another interesting thing I've been into is a dentist, sir. I gave a talk at the dental group and in Spokane, Washington, and they were, Smith, tell them about the liquid calories. I said, what are liquid calories? He said, those are calories that people are drinking, and they're getting their food from juices and liquid, and they're not chewing. And so the result in the end. So we've got to.
We should have some bulk.
Juice. Give them an apple instead of the apple juice.
Where
Mother Nature didn't make juice coming out of the trees.
So sometimes all these quick, snacks for calories sometimes look at the body the bulk you were eating.
That's right. There's a thing called Wolf's Law that if you don't exercise a certain part of the body, it may atrophy. Now you may take that's I mean about the jaw, or you know, if you just put your arm in a sling, it'll waste weight. If you lie in bed too long, why these muscles will waste away. So they're all, we've got to get going.
So use your muscles so they don't
atrophy. You talk a lot, and so your talking muscles are very good. And you should keep on talking. Once you stop, then your
jaw falls off.
So we're finding out a lot of things, and The things that we were taught any of these things in medical school, and like crowded teeth, you know, the underslung jaw and the teeth all crowded together.
We thought, well, what's the mixing of the races? It's mongrelization, because their parents are all mixed up, and we don't have the right kind of parents. But it's not that.
It's
nutrition. And they dug up skulls from, times, and they found that the perfect arch and nice form teeth and no cavities in these teeth.
Because they had something to...
Yeah, they chew it, and they didn't have the sugar in the white flour. So somehow, if Carter gets in, well, we'll all be into the peanut thing.
He's very good teeth.
Peanuts
are good for you, aren't they?
Yeah, maybe it helps your teeth, and he says a good joke. And it also has something to do with allergies, and the nose is bigger, and the whole face is a little wider.
Because you eat peanuts? The nose is
bigger? Yes, that is sure. Well, I don't know. I would say, but it's there's got to be some changes. And I think that people watching the show right now, if they want to get out of bed tomorrow morning, would get some peanuts or peanut butter or something, and be able to rise out of bed better in the morning. It seems to
peanut butter is very highly nutritious, isn't it?
It seems to be, but of course, if you eat a lot, you can get fat, like you can with anything. But it's better than other snacks that
why is it that certain people can eat anything and they're not gain weight? For example, I could eat 2 jars of peanut butter a day, and I would not physically gain weight.
You might burn it up faster in some strange way. It has a lot to do. There's something I didn't know until recently. The brain is a very busy organ. The brain, a fourth of our blood is
my busiest organ.
Yeah. It can
Wolf's Law got the other one a long time ago.
Spanking or hitting a child, you still have two almost opposite camps on this. A lot of people say you cannot hit a child because there's no way to train them. Other people say a good rod once in a while is effective. Is there any hard and fast rule?
I suppose it has a lot to do with the way you were reared, and if you're comfortable, because your parents were spanking you a lot.
I remember getting spanked once or twice, but not on any regular basis whatsoever.
No. Then you might do that because it's something you observe. I think it's the same thing with so many things that people find that you're comfortable with the lifestyle, whether it's good or bad in a home.
Right.
So you tend to perpetuate that, just like the battered child will often grow up to be the pattering parent.
But is there any data on whether it works as an effective deterrent for behavior?
It's just like the capital punishment doesn't seem to work. I think the same thing happens here. But there's, like everything else in the human scene, there are situations where it's maybe necessary. But if it's a lifestyle, then that's
very
detrimental. That'll hurt the personality. So everybody has a little...
I was going to say, I happen to have access to some expert information. As a daddy, I had to look it up. I mean, I did look it up in the Bible, find out what the Bible said about spanking.
The Bible says
In fact, it's all pro-spanking in the Bible.
Yeah.
Solomon says in Ecclesiastes, or Proverbs, a number of times in a number of ways that if you... beat, they use the word beat in the King James Bible. If you beat your child, you won't hurt him, but if you don't, he'll be an embarrassment to his parents. That's for some.
Tommy, because he's dull. No, great musician, but Tommy's idea of a big Saturday night is to sit in the closet and play with his digital watch. Ripped off in California by unscrupulous merchants or whatever. And today's tip is... stay away from any wax museum where the statues seem to have a 3-day growth of beard stubble.